This is an example of taking a literary source and turning it into a music lesson, or in other words, using music to enhance reading or literature in childhood. This is from a book, Christopher Robin's Storybook, by A.A. Milne himself. It's a collection of different stories and poems. It's just an outpouring of his creativity. A lot of them, most of them, are on the topic of Winnie the Pooh, but this is one that just is a small little glimpse of creative writing. On page 30-31 of this old book. And as you notice in the scans, the pages are grayed or yellowed and aged. I handled it very delicately. It was in our home library. Okay, so how to plan a lesson around something in a published source. Here I chose this one because there's actions, there's fun words to it. So how am I going to put music to it? This one, I'm going to use the concept of ostinato, or repeated pattern. My options could be using found sounds, which, since we're stuck at home doing online courses at the university level, that's the context of me creating these. I can just go around the house and I can, here's a wood part of a chair that I'm sitting in. That's no good. Here's the arm, the stuffed arm. That's not very good. Let me get up and walk around. Let me knock on the wall. Let me, here's a piece of exercise equipment. Here's a, so I'm going to look around. These are called found sounds. You can use found sounds anywhere you are with children. You reach out and have them explore. Here's a piece of plastic. Here's a cup, metal cup. Alright, sorry if that was loud. Here's a book. No, it doesn't make it very good. And there's all kinds of things you can do. Here's a stick or a pencil, and here's a bottle. Ooh, I like that one. I like that. Okay, then let me reach. Here's a box. Just a box that I got something in, and I still haven't packed it away and recycled it. Okay, so those are found sounds. We can also use vocal sounds, like ooh-ah, you know, imitating anything with the voice. We can use mouth percussion, without the vocal cords. We can use body percussion. Here's a snap, here's a pat, here's a, you know, pat on the knee, pat on the arm, here's a knock on my head. Okay, that's not very good to use. So different things, snap, clap, pop, stomp, except my wife doesn't want me to stomp because she's downstairs and she thought something was going on last time I did one of these. Okay, so we have different sounds that we can have anywhere we go. They're ourselves, body percussion, our voices, found sounds. That's what I'll focus on here. Okay, so let's devise a procedure. First, I'm going to follow a procedure teaching songs. Usually you give students something to do, some task to do as a result of you presenting the whole thing. And then you break it into parts, and then you have them do something holistically again. So the holistic run-through of this poem, I'm going to have them, let me see, come up with something that makes a sound. You can use a found sound, body percussion, or your voice, that represents a word, an object, or an action in this poem. Do it quietly so we can hear all of you together. This is called Halfway Down. And see the picture that A.A. Milne drew I can only guess that he drew it. He wrote the poem. There's little Winnie the Pooh at the top of the stairs. I think I see that. Okay, here it is. Halfway down the stairs is a stair where I sit. This isn't any other stair, quite like it. I'm not at the bottom. I'm not at the top. So this is the stair where I always stop. Halfway up the stairs isn't up and isn't down. It isn't in the nursery. It isn't in the town. And all sorts of funny thoughts run around my head. It isn't really anywhere. It's somewhere else instead. Okay, so during the course of that, you would acknowledge different students who are making quiet sounds, safe sounds, that little head, scruffing through my hair or on the beanie on my head, my little cap on my head, making scruffy sounds, make sure that they're safe and quiet and meaningful. The main thing is meaningful. So comprehension of words that you're reading. It keeps students alert, focused. You have evidence right away that they're doing something that pertains to the story time. Okay, so then you can pick from different sounds. Somebody went, whoop, of course I did, I'm the only one here. And ooh, for up and down, we could choose that. Maybe somebody found a sound that goes up in pitch or down in pitch. Something. But so students have explored a variety of sounds. You have total control to focus attention or reinforce. That's what this is, to reinforce positive examples for others to build around. And so you use the power of peer influence. You channel everybody's attention towards examples that you want to grow. And you ignore ones that you don't want to grow. So your attention is very powerful, and your pointing out examples is very powerful in the room. Okay, so the next step then. Okay, so you have a number of sounds students have made about stairs and sit and such. And so then you can do a number of things, get a consensus of their favorites, or just acknowledge the ones that they go ooh and ah, or collectively, you can just, again, reinforce the ones that seemed most appropriate, and you can decide or collaborate however you want. But once you decide, write it down, and that's your procedure for your lesson that's unique from other options other people use. So choose, explore options, then choose, write them down in a sequence. So that was step one, exploring and monitoring for appropriate sounds, meaningful sounds, quiet sounds, safe sounds. And I could write that in the formative assessment, assess those precise things, make sure that those are written in the lesson plan. Okay, step two then, let's take and make an ostinato. Instead of depicting the story piece by piece, let's do an ostinato with their favorite sounds or the sounds that work. So we've got and that means going up, sit, should go down. Kind of downward, and then sit. So halfway down the stairs is a stair where I sit. There isn't any other stair like it. And then you go bing again. Okay, and you involve different students making different sounds. Maybe you found a series of student sounds and asked them to organize them high to low. And then halfway up, when that switches, they got to switch order. Hey, now we're kind of into a math problem of creating a series. All right, So there, we just discovered something. I know what to do. Halfway down the stairs, and then halfway through the poem, it says halfway up. So we're going to make the music concepts pitch, rhythm, or beat, rhythm, because we don't want to just go boom, boom, but do do da da tink in this case. Now, I'm not going to dictate that. I'm going to allow that to freely come out of kids' exploration, and it's going to be different every lesson. So let's make an example, put it in the lesson plan, one solution, so everybody else who reads the lesson plan can see one solution worked out. So halfway down, so we're going to do pitch going high, pitches going low, and then that have to do with the saying or the story. Okay, so here we go. Now, step three. So we organize sounds in a way that's meaningful. We have an ostinato. Now we perform. Step three, we perform. Oh, let's go back one step. You could actually take and break kids into small groups, sort kids into small groups, and each of them come up with their own solution. And step two would be just an exploration. Step one would be exploration of sounds. Step two, break them into small groups and have them choose new sounds or use the ones they did, organize them going down and up in an ostinato, and we have multiple performances with narrator. Again, those are options. Okay, so here we go. Step three now, each group in turn or as a class. You might start out step one, exploring sounds, acknowledging them. Step two, do a class version. Step three, perform as a class. Step four, break into small groups and do various ones. So there's lots of options. I'd say keep it simple. Okay, so here we go. Last step, whether three or five, small group or full group. Here we go. Halfway down the stairs is a stair where I sit. There isn't any other stair quite like it. I'm not at the bottom. I'm not at the top. So there is a stair where I always stop. It's hard doing this, playing and saying at the same time. Here we go. Now, you're going to watch the students critically think and change the direction at this point. Write that into your lesson if that's important. That is a clue, a cue to comprehension. Halfway up the stairs isn't up. And halfway up the stairs isn't up. I can't get the rhyme. And isn't down. It isn't in the nursery. It isn't in the town. And all sorts of funny thoughts run round my head. It isn't really anywhere, it's somewhere else instead. And thus ends a nice sequential lesson plan incorporating music, creativity, performance, comprehension of text. Also, you could act it out. Have a series of actors, a series of performers. Have students recite it if they're at an age where their reading capabilities are up to this, or the teacher can be the voice of the narrator and students bring their comprehension to it. Okay, thank you. That was fun.